Hi Bhuvan, and a warm welcome to all of you joining us today.
As we discussed, it has an interesting hypothesis. Sri Lanka, the wildlife wonder of Asia. King of wonders, I am reminded of the stories of an Arab traveler called Ibn Battuta, who is widely recognized as one of the greatest travelers of all time. He traveled across continents and wrote about his travels. He called his chronicles a gift to those who contemplate the wonders of cities and the marvels of. He is quote, traveling leaves you speechless, then it turns you into a storyteller. It is said that Ibn Battuta visited Sri Lanka in 1344, and he had written about the wildlife he experienced during his journeys through Sri Lanka. Today, we want to talk to you about the gifts that Sri Lanka still has to offer to those who contemplate the wonders of the world and the marvels of traveling. This webinar is hosted by Aitken Spence Travels, Sri Lanka's largest destination management operation, and co-hosted by Aitken Spence Hotels, one of Sri Lanka's largest resort operators. As veterans in the industry, Aitken Spence Travels and Aitken Spence Hotels have also paved the way for many storytellers over the years. Both companies also know that the gifts of Sri Lanka to local and global travelers are still largely unexplored. Sri Lanka has the highest species density in the Asian region. Traveler can enjoy the majesty of the world's largest land mammal and wonder at the mystery of the world's largest marine mammal within a matter of hours. The pearl of the Indian Ocean has many more gems to offer our local and global visitors. And as we wait to welcome the world back to our home, after a short respite that also gave our popular wildlife destinations a much needed break, we thought it would be a perfect time to talk about Sri Lanka's wildlife and to talk about correctly curating experiences to explore the unexplored. My name is Yasangi Randani, and I have the privilege to moderate this session today. Our primary audience today are our tour operators, agents, partners, and other frontline members across the world. We also have a wider audience joining us on our Facebook live stream. A warm welcome to all of you once again. In the interest of the audience, I would like to explain how this webinar is structured. We will first hear our panelists speak for 10 minutes about their key topics. We will follow up the presentations with some key questions to each panelist before we open the floor for members of our audience to direct our questions. And to discuss this topic, we have with us a dream team of panelists. So without further ado, let's get right to it. First panelist is Dr. Sumit Pillapitiya. Dr. Sumit Pillapitiya is an environmental scientist with almost three decades of experience working in Asian countries in environment and wildlife conservation. He served in the World Bank for 23 years and was a lead environmental specialist for the South Asian region of the World Bank. During his stint at the World Bank, he has led many biodiversity and wildlife conservation projects across many countries. More recently, he was the Director General of Wildlife Conservation in Sri Lanka. He has personal research interests in elephant conservation and addressing the human-elephant conflict in Sri Lanka. He is currently conducting research on elephant social behavior in Minnaria, Kawadulla, and Yala National Parks. Today, he will talk to us about the potential for wildlife tourism in Sri Lanka, particularly the Sri Lankan elephants. Dr. Pillapitiya, good afternoon and over to you.
Thank you. And good day to everybody. I would like to take this opportunity to talk to you about what I feel Sri Lanka could be. That Sri Lanka could be termed the wildlife wonder of Asia. If we look at our biodiversity resources, my slides please. If we look at our biodiversity resources, Sri Lanka is considered a global biodiversity hotspot. Along with Western Ghats in India, we are one of the 34 such places in the world. Sri Lanka has also the highest biodiversity per unit area in Asia. And the country has an abundance of diverse ecosystems and many endemic species. Next, just to give you a snapshot of the faunal and floral diversity in Sri Lanka, we have about 4,000 species of flowering plants, 107 species of freshwater fish, 59 species of amphibians, 174 species of reptiles, 435 species of birds, and 140 species of mammals, all in a concise area of 65,000 square kilometers, which comprises our island. Next. When we say that Sri Lanka has tremendous wildlife tourism potential, it is not just a feeling that we have. It has been verified through studies that have been undertaken that if you take the countries listed out here, all Asian countries, Sri Lanka ranks number one in the wildlife tourism potential, which means that in the category of observability, which means that how easy it is to observe an animal or see wildlife, Sri Lanka ranks number one. In the time required to observe charismatic species, Sri Lanka has a ranking of two, which is just 2 days are required. In 2 days, you can basically see some form of charismatic species. Then when we look at the charismatic species index, we rank pretty high compared to some other countries. And finally, combined, we have the potential wildlife tourism rank, which we come number one. Next. So based on these unique resources, I think we really could consider ourselves the wildlife wonder of Asia, because Yala and Vilpattu National Parks are among the best places in the world to see leopards in the wild. Our leopards seem to be in these two parks, seem to be much more habituated to visitors than most leopards in the wild, because leopards are basically very elusive. But in these two parks, because of tourism, they have become a little more habituated, so observation of leopards becomes quite easy. Then we have Minnaria, Kaudulla, and Udavalave, which are some of the best places to see large herds of Asian elephants. And when you consider the 13 Asian elephant range states, these rank very high in places to see large groups of Asian elephants. We also have Merissa, Kalpitiya, and Trincomalee, which are among the best places in the world to see blue whales and sperm whales. And we have a plethora of rainforests, some of which are part of the global biodiversity hotspot area. And we also have several natural world heritage sites. Some of the most endemic amphibians and reptiles can be found in some of these rainforests of Sri Lanka. So when you consider all this, and the mere fact that it can all be experienced in a very short time to fit within a tourist schedule, so that you don't have to be traveling days and days to see all this, I think Sri Lanka has the potential of being one of the best wildlife tourism destinations outside Africa and easily a wildlife wonder of Asia. However, next slide. However, we have to be quite careful to make sure that we can achieve this potential. Could I have the next slide, please? Because the way we have been managing our tourism leaves a little bit to be desired. Because we have overcrowded parks and badly behaved safari jeeps as well as drivers. Go back, please. So therefore, Sri Lanka has to rebrand its wildlife tourism if it wants to reach this potential. There are plans in the government to try to improve nature interpretation so that the visitor experience is much better than what it is today. Then there are also plans for introducing more stringent regulations for visitor management in parks. The government has already started a program where safari jeep drivers to national parks will be permitted only if they're trained and they're certified as safari jeep drivers. And one such program has been initiated in the central part of Sri Lanka, the north central part of Sri Lanka. And all safari jeep drivers to Minnaria, Kaudulla national parks at present have undergone this training, and they have to be certified and have been certified. So only they are permitted. And this plan is going to be program is going to be extended to other parks as well. And so very soon it will be only trained safari jeep drivers that will be permitted into national parks. And in the long term, there are plans to identify and develop high-end wildlife tourism. So to classify certain parks and develop it uniquely for high-end tourism, which would be very low volume but high revenue generating locations where the nature interpretation experience and observation experience will be very much better. And we are also trying to attract visitors who are actually those who are really interested in observing wildlife into our national parks. Today, I think national parks are put on every package tour to the country. And we have noticed that many tourists who are not really interested in wildlife are also part of this tourism experience in wildlife parks, overcrowding the parks and reducing the wildlife tourism experience for everybody. So for the future, the government is trying to ensure that only visitors who are really interested in observing wildlife will be sent to national parks. And this is what we would like to appeal to tour operators and tourism destination management companies to try to make sure that wildlife parks are not put on every single tour package. There are people who like to go to wildlife parks and people who don't are also sent into the park, which creates serious problems within our parks. Now, next slide, please. Now, I would like to spend a few minutes, couple of minutes, talking about elephant viewing tourism in Sri Lanka. Elephants are one of the most charismatic species, and they are a main attraction in our national parks. But the Asian elephant is listed as an endangered species. While Sri Lanka has the second largest population of Asian elephants among the 13 range states, we have around 6,000 elephants in the wild. Sri Lanka has the highest population density of elephants among the range states. And elephants can be observed almost in all our dry zone national parks, as well as in a couple of the wet zone areas where there is a much smaller population of elephants in the wet zone parks. But the elephant is under threat in Sri Lanka because Sri Lanka has the highest human elephant conflict in the world, and elephant deaths are close to 400, averaging around 400 elephants being killed every year as a result of the conflict, not really for ivory poaching, because we have only about 5 to 6% of the males having tusks. So it is largely due to the conflict as a result of crop raiding, etc. Next slide, please. Now, as a visitor, if you are visiting Sri Lanka for elephant viewing tourism, we have different options to cater to everybody's need. We have national parks like Yala and Udawalewe, which have been somewhat over visited. So because of the over visitation, elephants have got pretty habituated to visitors. Unfortunately, the habituation has also resulted in behavior modification of the animals, but you will be also be able to see, observe some interesting behaviors in these parks because the elephants are somewhat habituated to vehicles, so vehicles don't bother them too much. We also have Udawalewe National Park, which is a park that any time of the day you go, from the time the park opens till the park closes, you're virtually guaranteed of seeing elephants. Even in the middle of the heat of the day, you would see elephants in that park. Next slide, please. Similarly, we have opportunities for people who want to observe. Next slide, please. Similarly, we have opportunities for observing elephants in their, when their behavior is considered to be more natural. In parks, go back one, please. In parks such as Madurai National Park, Galloway National Park, Wasgamo National Park, Kumana National Park are parks where visitation is not very high. Therefore, you see elephants behaving much more naturally than parks that are over-visited. So very interesting behavior, particularly very natural behavior, can be observed in these parks. But the visitor has to make sure that the visitor is unobtrusive to the elephants. So a lot of patience is needed, but while doing that, you will be able to observe, you will be rewarded. Your patience will be rewarded because you will see some very interesting observations. Then the next slide, please. We have the best known place for elephant viewing in Sri Lanka, which is the Minnearia and Kaudula National Parks, best known for large elephant populations. Lonely Planet listed Minnearia as one of the 10 wildlife wonders of the world. This is the largest Asian elephant gathering, and it's known as the Great Elephant Gathering of Asia. There is 300 to 400 elephants during the peak of the gathering season, which is in the months of August and September. Elephants come in such large numbers during this time of the year because they congregate on the grasslands of these large reservoirs, and you see get an uninterrupted view of their behavior. You could see lots of interesting interactions, and this is one place that it's quite common to see elephants mating, which is quite a difficult thing because we have forest elephants in Sri Lanka and you don't see that type of behavior. But here you see elephants mating, you get opportunities of seeing male-male competition trying to attract the female for mating. You see cases where females do choose the mates that they consummate with. So there is lots of very, very interesting behaviors that you could see in Minnearia National Park. So Minnearia and Kawdulla are places where very large gatherings of elephants can be seen. So like I said, I have just given you just a snapshot of three completely different types of behavior that you could see within this small country in different national parks. And finally, we also have the only recorded, the next slide please. We also have the only recorded albino elephant in the wild in one of our national parks. While albinos have been recorded as captive elephants, this is the only recorded sighting of a albino elephant in the wild in the entire world. So we even have that in our parks. And just to conclude, we plan on resetting the way wildlife tourism is promoted. We plan on targeting and marketing our natural parks for its unique resources. We plan on improving visitor experience, and we plan on maintaining our natural assets, because long-term sustainable tourism depends on how well Sri Lanka maintains its natural assets. So we plan on developing the country into a globally renowned high-end wildlife tourism destination and make wildlife tourism a driver and a major contributor to the economy of Sri Lanka and make Sri Lanka a land in harmony with nature. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Pilipitiya. Indeed, a lot to consider when planning a visit to Sri Lanka, and not only for our global tourists, for us as Sri Lankans also, I believe there's a lot that we can consider when planning a visit to another part of our own country. Thank you again, Dr. Pilipitiya. So from the largest land mammal, we will now move over to marine mammals. The waters around Sri Lanka is home to 28 marine mammals, and perhaps the most popular of those are the dolphins and the blue whales. For us in Sri Lanka, we cannot think about blue whales without thinking about the lady, who is a champion for these gentle giants. Dr. Asha Divos is an internationally acclaimed Sri Lankan marine biologist, ocean educator, and a pioneer of long-term blue whale research within the Northern Indian Ocean. She has established her own Sri Lankan-grown non-profit organization called Ocean Swell, which is the first marine conservation research and education organization in Sri Lanka. Speaking of firsts, Dr. Divos is the first and only Sri Lankan to have a PhD in marine mammal research, the first Pew Fellow in marine conservation, the first National Geographic explorer from Sri Lanka, and the first Sri Lankan woman to have her portrait hung at Oxford University. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Dr. Asha Divos as she talks to us about whales and marine life in the context of tourism promotion. Dr. Divos, over to you.
Good afternoon, everybody. Hopefully you can hear me. Maybe you can see me. Okay, so it's a real pleasure to speak to all of you today. And more than just a pleasure, I think it's actually fundamental that we have these conversations more and more, especially as we now move toward this imminent reopening of travel to Sri Lanka. That said, much of what I want to talk about today is really not only related to like this post-COVID situation. It really is a conversation that we should have been having for a long time, but we haven't. We've never really paused to think about how we open our country out to the world. This has been a very unique time for us, and it has allowed for this. And so it gives us a pause for thought on how we actually market our natural assets to the world. And so I want to start off by saying thank you very much to Aitken Spence for organizing this event and inviting me to speak. I'm going to actually talk through, obviously, my personal experiences. So if we can just pull up the first slide. I'm just going to highlight my story through this one particular incident. A couple of years ago, I was out on the water in Virissa, where I do most of my research, and we encountered this mother calf pair of blue whales. Now, I want to point out first and foremost that seeing blue whales, seeing whales in general, they're elusive beasts in a very large ocean, but seeing a mother calf pair is really quite rare, and so it's a very special event. During the time that we observed this mother calf pair, we saw, next slide please. We were able to observe a range of behaviors from the calf. So here we see the calf doing what we call spy hopping, where it pokes its head out and looks around. Next slide, you will see the calf breaching, so jumping out of the water. We saw it rolling, and we also saw it potentially feeding from the mother. Now, these are all behaviors that we don't see with the adults in a hurry or at all. Their blue whales don't tend to be as sort of showy as a species. And so therefore, this was incredibly unique for us to observe. And when I told people about this, everyone turned around and said, wow, you're so lucky. You know, it was a very lucky moment. And then I paused and I reminded people. I said, look, you know what? It is all about how you approach that encounter, right? So for us with our work, we'll go out, we'll find animals, okay? Because that's the premise of what we do. We are focusing on blue whales. But when we find them, we switch off our boat engines and we sit, okay? And so rather than us going behind the animals and drown the animals, we actually sit and let these animals do what they do best in as natural a space as they can. So with this encounter, we were the only boat on the water that day. Next slide, please. So a couple of days later, we were back out on the water, and this was actually a video, but the video doesn't seem to be playing, but that's okay. It's basically a bunch of boats and there's a whale that's being chased down, right? So that's the premise of what's going on. It's like a miracle. A couple of days later, we were back on the water, and we saw 15 to 20 boats charging behind a mother calf pair. Turns out it was the exact same pair. Behaviors were completely different, okay? So you had, they were surging, they were clearly trying to get away. They were showing evidence of horizontal and vertical avoidance. So by that we mean they were diving and then just kind of vanishing for long periods of time. They were spending very little time on the surface. So it was a very much more stressful sort of environment. And we know from research that, and research around the world, not just our research, that what happens in these situations, when in the presence of a lot of, in the presence of whale watching boats, is that these animals will get stressed. They'll start to avoid if you're not encountering properly. If the noise is too much, they will also start to shorten their time on the surface and try to dive and sort of get out of the way, right? So these are things that we've seen. And the problem with this is if you think about it, right, like, if the mother has to reduce her time at the surface, she's reducing her rest time. It might be interfering with her time feeding the calf. There's a moving at that rate involves a lot more energy. So she's kind of eating into her energy stores. That means that there's much less of her to give to her calf. There's much less energy that she has to live her own life. And that's obviously detrimental in the long term, right? So this can have long-term impacts on the calves. It has been shown to affect growth of calves. So these are problems that we have been documented in other places in the world. And it's something that can very easily happen here if we don't start to think about how we want to manage our whale watching industry. Can we go to the next slide, please? And so Sri Lanka also, like, you know, this is one aspect of our sort of marine mammal tourism, which is the most popular one where people get out on boats and go and look at these whales. But there's another form also, and that is the swimming with whales that happens here. Now, first and foremost, I want to point out that largely swimming with whales is not legal. If you look at the laws, it says we can't unless you have express permission from the DG of the Department of Wildlife. But what we see is that there's a lot of operators out there basically dropping people in the water without any consideration of the safety of the people nor of the animals, okay? And it's all driven by a simple thing, which is basically Facebook likes. Can we have the next slide, please? So this is a screenshot, basically, of a Facebook page that I saw. And you can see here the comments that this person has made. They've gone into the water, they've tried to get really close, and the comment was a little too close. I was bent on getting as close as I could, right? So all they cared about was getting that image, that video of this animal with little consideration for the animal itself that they're photographing and trying to get like mileage off, right? And again, this is driven by that desire to get Facebook likes, which is a very unfortunate world that we live in, that that's what like qualifies people's popularity and stuff. But there's a real problem when it comes to wildlife viewing. People want that like, so they'll do anything to get that like. In this picture, you can see it's a screenshot from a video, but the whale is actually diving down. The vast majority of videos that you'll see of blue whales underwater is just that. And that means there's an avoidance behavior going on. They're not comfortable. They're trying to get out of the way. Okay. So this is, again, problematic. Next slide. And this is, again, let me remind you, it's not a legal activity, though it happens a lot. And we need to think about that and how we curtail, how we can be responsible. On the next, so the point being that, you know, we look out of sight, out of mind, right? We live on land. Our country is a very shore-based back place. Our life ends at the shoreline. Most people won't interact with the ocean, but the ocean is a very stressful place. These animals live in very stressful environments. Basically, they're weaving in and out of one of the busiest shipping lanes in the world. The biggest threat to the blue whales out here is that they get hit by ships and get killed. Our southern coast is home to one of the biggest shipping lanes because everything from Dubai to Singapore is traveling through this. It's the main artery through the Indian Ocean, right? So they're dealing with that stress. On top of that, they get entangled in fishing nets. Also, the ocean is getting noisier. And while we might go for a swim or a snorkel and think about how beautiful and peaceful it is underwater, if your life depended on you being able to hear what's going on around you, and whales don't have great eyesight, but they communicate and they navigate the world through their ears. As we increase the number of ships and boats charging around them, the noise is increasing. That increases the stress levels. It increases the energy that's consumed by them to kind of like modify their behavior. So just think about like if you're at a cocktail party and there's a bunch of people around and everyone's talking loud and you want your friend across the table to hear you, you have to talk louder, right? So you're wasting more energy trying to talk louder just to be heard. And in these situations, these animals depend on sound to find their mates, to find their family members, to find their food. And so if they're unable to do that, that's actually hugely problematic. So why I want to talk about this is because I want you to remember that it's not just that they're dealing with these human-induced threats. We're adding those threats on top of all the other disruptions that they have to navigate in their lives. Next slide, please. So this is the kind of thing we end up seeing. We don't want our interactions to end up like this, right? Animals trying to get out of the way, getting hit by vessels, or basically, you know, this constant escape or just our human-induced threats having a really bad negative impact on these populations. Next slide, please. So what I want to say is, look, there are lots of things we can do, right? Like, the ocean is a vast space. Let's not forget, ocean is 70% of our planet. It is very hard to govern and to enforce regulations in these spaces. That means we have to be far more responsible in these places than we do have to be on land. I'm not saying we don't have to be responsible, but there's very few eyes on the water to watch and to correct behavior. So that is all of our duty as conservationists, but also as tour operators, as people trying to market the nation. It is so important that you remember you are part of this whole whole endeavor to protect and conserve these species, and you can do it. Your role is very large and it's very obvious. So basically things like, for example, here, so one of the things is do your homework, right? Like, who are you partnering with? Are they safe? And when we say safe, I don't just mean there are operators who have life jackets on board or have seasickness tablets, because that's the metric we're using in Sri Lanka at the moment, which is not appropriate. We need to think beyond that. Well, one thing is, do they have communication devices? And I can tell you from experience, I've rescued 2 boatloads of tourists that have been floating around in the shipping lanes for over 8 hours with no signal or communication with them. Okay, that's not a good thing. It's not a good advertisement for Sri Lanka's tourism. So we have to think about who we're partnering with. Are they safe for not just people, but also for the animals? Do they care? Are they responsible? That's really, really important. Are they focused purely on income, or are they actually focused on that experience? Do they guarantee sightings of blue whales? So one of the big problems that I find here is that we're always guaranteeing 90%, 99% chance of seeing a blue whale, which means then we are overlooking everything else. what we should be proud of, the ocean experience that we can give. I can tell you, you can see sailfish, turtles, flying fish, dolphins, various sorts of creatures on the water, mantas, whale sharks. We see them all on the ocean. But because we're so focused at showing blue whales, what happens is the boats go out, they just target this blue whale. They'll see other things, they'll bypass it, and they'll go straight for the blue whales. Some tourists have told me they've sometimes felt kidnapped because they've been on these trips for so long because they've been promised a blue whale. And then the tour operator feels this pressure to purely show this blue whale, regardless of everything else that's out there. So our marketing needs to change. What are we trying to sell? What is it that we can show? And we have potential to show so much more than just one species. And that's super, super important. And that way we can reduce the pressure on these whales also. We have to remind whoever we are talking to, we have to always remind there's no guarantee. This is nature. There's a high chance you'll go out on the water for 8 hours and come back, see nothing. That is nature, right? So we have to think about that also in our marketing. We have to discourage bad behavior. All of us have a responsibility, right? So if you have clients or if you're selling these tours, remember to ask your clients, how was the trip? If they report bad behavior, act on it. Don't just file it away for later, right? Because the more we all voice that our unhappiness about things that are not being done well, the more we can actually start to build a better tourism product. And just like Sumit says, we can actually start to create a product that actually can bring in more income and bring a more stable clientele to Sri Lanka as well. Educate yourselves. You know, it's like with if you create a product, if you have a product, you're always going to know everything, the ins and outs and how it's made and what the wheres and the whats and the wherefores. And I would say, educate yourself as much as possible about all these species and ecosystems that you're celebrating and talking about externally. Know the problems, know the threats, because if you know the threats, then you can give the best advice to your clients. Because a lot of the time you'll also find that clients want to know, and they also want to know the ground situation. And I get lots of emails from tourists who want to come to Sri Lanka who will say, oh, I don't want to come because it's, I don't want to go on a normal whale watching boat because I've heard that, you know, they don't behave well or anything. And can we come out with you? Now, I can't accommodate that because I'm a scientific research vessel. But the point being, these are points that we need to listen to so that we can actually hone the product we're giving out. Encourage respect for nature. Certainly, you know, it shouldn't be about getting as close as possible. You're not going to get your best encounters anyways. But anyways, we should be able to stand up and say, look, no, we can't go any closer. If you go on a tour with us, then you're going to be, you know, we're going to adhere with the regulations and make sure we're not getting in the way, disrupting, and you will have a much better experience, like I talked about at the start of this. Little things like encourage, you know, when you give food packs and stuff like that, don't just give disposable stuff, plastic bottles. Encourage tourists when they're coming from their countries to bring their own water bottles, right, to carry like that's long lasting. So we can start to be much more conscious of what's happening around us and make a statement for our own country for this. And also, you know, even if you're not from Sri Lanka, like, you're a citizen of this world. We have an absolute responsibility as citizens of this world to caretake, whether it's in our backyard or someone else's backyard. And we should take that incredibly seriously. Next slide, please. And then the last point I want to make is there are so many opportunities to also support science and research. And that's really quite a nice way to build your packages. So here, for example, I'm just very briefly, we do what we call photo identification, where we take pictures of different parts of the different whales and dolphins that we see. All the dolphins and whales that we see on the water, we have catalogs. And we take photographs so that we can identify and re-identify individuals over and over again. So now this was a photograph taken by someone in 1984. If you go to the next slide, please. And you will see that in 2011, I took this picture. And I'm sure you're all gasping in the audience. I can't hear you, unfortunately. But it's the same whale, right? You can see there are particular markings that tell you it's the same whale. I don't know what happened in between those times, but 27 years later, this animal is still hanging around in our waters. How important is that? Next slide, please. So this is the oldest known blue whale in the Northern Indian Ocean. And how do we figure this out? Through photographs. This is a simple thing that all, you know, when you're getting people out, if you're giving them the opportunity to go on this package, make sure, like Sumit says, like, we want people who are actually interested in this. And this is how we can make them more interested. Let them know of the opportunity to contribute to science and conservation in the country that they are going to. That is Sri Lanka in this case. Here you'll see a map. And basically what I'm trying to say is there are basically where we saw the whale in 2011 was less than 10 kilometers away from where it was seen 27 years later. That is huge, and that's significant for conservation, because the more we do surveys in these areas, the more we see animals revisiting areas, that allows us to hone where we're doing our conservation work and really focus on how to protect very, very important areas around our coastline. So I think it is really important for us to all remember that everyone can get involved. And when you're selling a product, it shouldn't just be about, we're not selling a product, right? These are not, this is not a commodity. We're just basically trying to encourage people to have an experience of a lifetime and reminding them that it is truly an experience of a lifetime. Blue whales are the largest animals that have ever roamed our planet. We have the privilege to live side by side with them. And that is exactly how we should see it. Next slide, please. So with that, we have to remember we are, this is our heritage, our global heritage. These are a very special population of blue whales, but we have special populations of sperm whales and a lot of different species. We are simply custodians. So our job is to make sure that we pass these species on intact and their habitats to the next generation. So what is it that we all can do? We can all be responsible. We can all do something to take care of these species and their ecosystems. And again, we have to remember that conservation of resources is not just down to conservationists. Every single one of us has a role to play in whatever job we have, whatever job we take. And we must be proud of what we have and continue to stand our ground. Next slide, please. And with that, I want to say thank you very much. And I look forward to the discussion to ensue after.
Thank you, Dr. DeVos. Indeed, as wondrous as nature is, we must not forget individual responsibility to protect our wildlife. In a massive ecosystem, as is the marine ecosystem, we're missing the bigger picture in that hunt for an FB picture or an Instagram click. And we must not forget that in our quest for an experience, we must not create traumatizing experiences for wildlife. Thank you once again, Dr. DeVos. We would now like to bring our audience back to land to talk about another majestic mammal, the leopards of Sri Lanka. With us today, we have Ms. Anjali Watson, an ecologist by training. Ms. Watson has focused much of her work over the last two decades on wildlife research and conservation. She is the co-founder and manager of the Wilderness and Wildlife Conservation Trust. Part of her husband and wife's zoologist and ecologist team, her husband, Dr. Andrew Kittle, and Ms. Watson have conducted extensive research on the leopard in Sri Lanka, as well as many other species across multiple habitats over many continents. Their work highlighted the importance of conserving ecosystems to protect the Sri Lankan leopard. A member of the IUCN Species Survival Commission's cat specialist group since the year 2000. She sits on many government advisory panels. They maintain an island-wide distribution map of leopards, which is utilized to determine the status of the Sri Lankan leopard for IUCN's red list. It was this data that helped to identify the Sri Lankan leopard as globally endangered. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Ms. Anjali Watson.
Good afternoon, everybody. And I think good morning and good evening to some people as well, because there are people from across the globe here. Thank you for having me here. Actually, when I was first asked to do this, I kind of laughed at first, because I thought that sometimes, you know, as scientists and now conservationists, we're often coming head to head with the tourism industry as well. But like Asha just mentioned, especially because we are studying charismatic species, single species that many people from across the globe come to watch and go to many nations to watch, I think there's a role for us to play. As the species does in the ecosystem, we also need to take that role now and spearhead the rights and wrongs of where wildlife tourism is going today. So thank you for having me on this, because I think, as Asha mentioned, it's a good pivotal point. We here in Sri Lanka stand at a good point now where we're reopening up our country. We're also at a junction when it comes to wildlife and how we want to look at our wildlife here from a tourism perspective, and where we want to go with this. You know, we can be a leader, we really can. So I think it's time that these kinds of conversations, as Asha rightly mentioned, and Sumit talked about, you know, having high-end tourism with a focus, a clear focus on where we want to go as a nation, needs to be had. So I'm going to focus on the Sri Lankan leopard, which fortunately or unfortunately has in the past few decades become an extremely sought after species to come and take a look at. I have the next slide. I just want to put it into perspective first globally. Of all of the panthers, the big cats, it is the leopard, could you click please, that is the most adaptable of all the big cats. And because it is the most adaptable, globally it has been thought by most people that it did not stand threatened and that there wasn't really much of an issue. It was the lions and so on, the tiger, of course, that was looked at. Could we have the next slide? As well, globally, the leopard has 9 subspecies. So they are widely spread. Next slide. And it's this widespread across the globe within these 9 species that led many people to think that there was no issue with leopards. But recent studies are showing clearly that 60% of its range globally has been lost. What you're seeing here, the gray area, is basically the lost in historic range. The green is what we know of populations existing today, and the orange is where there are possibly extinct populations. So there is actually a dramatic change that's occurring. And I think the leopard is coming under much more of a microscope right now to try to understand globally what is going on. And also, as you can see here, many of these populations are pocketed. They're in small populations. So that also stands to increase the threat for these animals. We here in Sri Lanka, could you click please, are lucky enough to still have leopards on our island. Panthera pardus cottia is the subspecies. So can we go to the next slide? And this is something very special for us because it is the only terrestrial land predator that we have. It stands at the top of our food chain. It holds no competitors. So there is no competition from lions, from tigers, from wild dogs, from hyenas. It is only the leopard that we have in our terrestrial system. So it truly is the king of our jungles. Now added to this, next clip, is the fact that it is the only place on Earth where this has occurred, where this animal has evolved as such for tens of thousands of years. There are more recent examples in Java, for example. Sadly, recently, the Javanese tiger has gone extinct, but that is more recent. So, in Sri Lanka, it is the only island population, it is the only population of leopard that has evolved as such as being one top terrestrial predator. Next, please. And the other wonderful thing about the Sri Lankan leopard, like globally you saw it was widespread, although its population is getting pocketed, is that we also have the leopard throughout our country, from our mountain cloud forests to our rainforests to our monsoon evergreen forests, which you see here, to our coastal plains. So it truly is showing its adaptability here on this island as well. Next slide, please. And this feeds in to how do we value such a species. Now, personally for me, and I'm sure for many people who come to look at the leopard, this is a magnificent beast. It has something about it, alluring about it. So for its own value, its intrinsic value, it is essential that we ensure it continues to exist. But also it has an ecological value. Next slide, please. Which is actually far more than meets the eye. It is very charismatic, as Sumit pointed out earlier as well. So it is key as a flagship for overall conservation. It is also a possible keystone species, which means that its influence on a system is actually more than its actual number. Next click, please. Now added to this is the fact that here in Sri Lanka especially, is that it is wide ranging, as I said earlier. This is a map of its distribution. The hatched areas you're seeing is where we are confirming current breeding populations and the range of it. Now go back please. It is distributed throughout the island, other than for, of course, where human population is highest. So what this is that it's an umbrella species, which means that we can use the leopard, because it's so widespread, where it roams and how it uses the landscape terrestrially, to attempt our conservation focused on this species. Because by default, all those landscapes and all of the other species underneath will also be falling under this umbrella of conservation. Next slide, please. Now, what about its economic value? I mean, today, unfortunately, everything has to be made into dollars and cents, but there is the benefits of that too, because it allows everybody to maybe have the understanding that otherwise it would not be taken into consideration. Tourism in Sri Lanka, as most of us know, is the number three earner here. Added to that, in the past two decades, and I say this again, it's only in the past two decades that wildlife tourism and our wildlife parks have come into the forefront for tourism. Yala National Park, which is our highest visited national park, takes the lion's share, or the leopard share in this case, of that visitation. A short study that we did of visitors in Yala, click again please, showed that over 50%, click again, yeah, 58% of visitors came to see leopards. Of that, about 30% came only with the sole purpose of seeing a leopard. So there is a huge change that has occurred here traditionally. I mean, traditionally it was always sun, sea, and our culture and so on. So, but in the past two decades, we are seeing, for good or bad, we are seeing that this is happening. Wildlife tourism is becoming a big thing. And leopard tourism, again, has become a huge peak in that. So as the other speakers mentioned before, we need to be really careful about where we're going with this. Next slide, please. So this brings us now, with that understanding, to certain questions, conservation questions around the visitation and the focusing on wildlife tourism and leopards in specific here, of course. Next click, please. The biggest question, of course, which is, you know, currently raging as well, is, are we watching the leopard today? Have we gone beyond the brink? Is this too much? I mean, most of us know that in certain parks that there is some crazy scenarios that do occur, where a leopard gets, you know, cut off completely from crossing a road, where people are off-road all over the place. Recently, actually last year, a study was done in India on two well-known tiger reserves, Kanha and Bandhavgarh, where they looked at the stress hormone in tigers and they compared it to visitation seasons, tourism and anthropogenic use of the park and during high tourist season. And there was a clear significant indication that during the high tourist season, the stress hormones in the tigers rose. And it actually correlated very strongly with the number of vehicles in the park as well. Now, this shows that it could, in time, impact their reproduction, their reproductive ability, and their survival in the long run. Next slide, please. So then this takes us to the next question that I'd like to put forward. Are we forgetting something here? You know, we all want to see the leopard, we want to watch it and so on. What about its unseen needs that we don't think of? What about alternate options for us as well to not always want to see the animal? A leopard is a wide-ranging species. It needs a lot of space, which is why I mentioned earlier about the umbrella concept and how it's good for conservation. So it is present throughout this island. They're there, even though you may not see them. Should we be thinking, therefore, that by still being in these beautiful landscapes and knowing that the leopard is present there, you are still contributing towards its conservation, one, and two, you can actually look at something else other than just the animal. The fact that this animal is present in these wonderful landscapes as well. So alternate choices about how we look at where we want to go when we travel. We are missing the forest for the trees, as it were, when you go running around looking at just that species. If we can consider what this species is, what it needs, and the beautiful scapes that we have on this island where it is present, as an option that we want to visit, that's really a good alternate option here. Next click, please. Now, many of us will firmly say, oh, we don't contribute this. This is an insidious act here. It is something that is still there and on the rise. Illegal wildlife trade is the third largest illegal trade in the world after trading of humans and drug trafficking. We may not think that we openly do this or lend to this, but again here, this does occur, and often it occurs unseen to many of us. So choices again about who are we supporting, where are we going. We may not think we're buying something illegal and contributing to the illegal wildlife trade, but perhaps if you visit a place where you go and pet a baby a leopard or a baby tiger, that animal has come from an illegal source, no doubt. You may not eat bushmeat, but you may visit a restaurant or go to a shop where they actually in the back room will be providing for that. So all these little things, I think it's good to have out in the open, for people to consider, and voice as the demand side of what it is you would like to see as well. Could I go to the next slide, please? So I think this all kind of, all of our talks brings us to this point. Wildlife tourism is definitely a balancing act. There's the good, there's the bad. And if the two can be carefully managed, as Sumit mentioned, and that balancing act can be successfully achieved for a small nation such as Sri Lanka that does have such high biodiversity and that we are already on the footpath of wildlife tourism, we could try to make it successful. We could actually try to make it more than that and make it a conservation policy where it works for us. Because at the end of the day, we must all remember that we don't want to kill the goose that laid the golden egg. So I'll just end with that now. And I hope, next slide please, that that we have all, and with my talk as well, given you some food for thought and some key pointers. I think we've all reiterated similar points with our different focuses. That as a visitor, as a guest, as a inbound tour operator, that you could relook at what you are offering and what we as a nation in Sri Lanka are offering and how you also could demand for certain things. Because if there isn't a demand for those bad things, they will slowly die out. You know, if there isn't a demand for ivory, at the end of the day, ivory poaching will stop. If there isn't a demand for horrible methods of, you know, viewing animals and moving around the landscape, that will slowly ease off by default. So I would like to also put the onus on guests to our country, visitors to our country and tour operators to take some onus there and some responsibility to say, this is what we're offering. Please honor that, adhere to that, and respect that. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Watson. Indeed, I think that's a very important point that you brought up, that often we forget the individual responsibility of 21 million Sri Lankans and 7 billion people on the planet to protect the wonders of this wonderful planet that we live on. And I think unseen needs need to be at the forefront of our considerations when we plan tours, be it as a tour operator or as a guest and a visitor to this wonderful country. One thing I also know for sure is how little I know about my own country. And I sincerely hope our audience as visitors as well would absorb what was shared by all three of our panelists. Now, I have many questions to ask, so let's get straight to it. Let's move on to the first round of questions. And yes, I am going to use the privilege of my position as the moderator and ask the first round of questions from our panelists. So my first question is to Dr. Pillapitiya. Dr. Pillapitiya, before we went into lockdown, one of the pressing matters that we had for wildlife tourism was the congestion in national parks like Yala, which you addressed in your presentation as well. In fact, for several years now, Aitken Spence Travels has worked towards encouraging travelers to visit other national parks to relieve some of this congestion in Yala. Moving forward, in your opinion, what type of excursions or parks can we introduce in other parts of the country for high-end tourism as a solution to this problem? Dr. Pillapitiya, over to you.
Thank you. See, when we look at overcrowding of parks in Sri Lanka, we have problems of overcrowding in only six of our national parks. Yala National Park, Udawala Bay, Min Area, Kaudulla, Horton Plains, and Wilpapa. None of the other national parks are overcrowded. So before the other national parks get overcrowded, it is right now time for the government to set in place the guidelines so that you don't let those parks get overcrowded. First of all, I would strongly urge the government to put limits of the number of vehicles getting into all the other parks. Leave the overcrowded parks aside because that has much more complications to deal with, but all the other parks that they could do that. So that we are ensuring that none of those parks get overcrowded by us trying to redistribute tourism, because at this point, we don't want to ruin all our national parks. We've ruined six of them to a large extent. Then the government has to really identify which parks that they would like to develop for high-end tourism. And high-end tourism is very low volume, high-priced tourism with a very high quality experience being provided to the tourists. Right? So the government has already identified Galloway National Park and Madurai National Park as two potential sites for high-end tourism, to be developed as high-end tourism sites. One thing we must first realize is just because you designate a site as high-end tourism, it doesn't automatically become a high-end tourism site. There's a lot of work that needs to be done before we can get there. So we should be looking at offering different packages for different parks. I don't want to by saying we should redistribute the tourists. I don't want to make all our parks overcrowded because that will be a disaster, right? So we first need to bring in the regulations in the other parks and then slowly try to distribute a little more tourism into those parks, but not exceeding the caps that have been put in place. And the main reason is people have to realize, like I said in my presentation also, that while the government of Sri Lanka might want to attract 2.5 million or 3 million or 5 million tourists to Sri Lanka, that doesn't necessarily mean all 2.5 million tourists have to go to national parks. We should try to be very selective and take people who enjoy nature to national parks and marine sanctuaries rather than everybody. Because that way the people who go also enjoy it, and then we are protecting our resources. So my approach would be that identify some national parks for high-end tourism, some national parks that are not over-visited for limited visitation, and then start dealing with the over-visited parks to gradually reduce the visitation there. And the people who can help in doing managing the over-visited parks, reducing tourism more than the government, is actually the tour operators. Don't send unnecessary people who are not interested in wildlife to national parks as part of a package tour. So if we take that approach, I think we would be heading in the right direction and we could become the wildlife wonder of Asia. But the way we are going now, we certainly won't become.
Thank you, Dr. Pilavitia. And indeed, I believe Aitken Spencer Travels has been a champion in this area as well, where we have worked with our reservations teams and our tour guides and chauffeur guides and pretty much everyone that works with us to educate them about the needs of the ecosystems and environment to make sure that in our share our wondrous environment with the world, that we don't destroy it in the process. A lot to think about there as well. Thank you, Dr. Pilavitia. Dr. DeVos, I would like to come to you next. Many tourists visit Sri Lanka, especially for that beach vacation or to see whales and dolphins, as you said in your session as well. What things should we consider when encouraging marine-related activities around the island, especially in tourism? Do you have any thoughts about that?
All right. Thank you so much for that question. That's great. So I did, I had 10 minutes, so it's very hard to talk about. Remember that the ocean is 8 times more surface. We have 8 times more ocean area than land area in this country. So when I'm given 10 minutes to talk about the oceans, it's a little bit tricky to try to get everything in. Okay. So which is why, like, I focus my talk on sort of whale-related tourism, but there are other forms. For example, another thing is that people come to Sri Lanka and they'll maybe go snorkeling. So what I also want to, I'll take a step back. Let me just connect to what Sumit said, because he said, you know, don't encourage people who are not interested to do certain activities. And I'm totally going to second that. That's exactly what I was talking about when I said, as tour operators, you have an absolute role as agents. If you're bringing people to the country, don't just send them to places, because then you can build an itinerary for them. Build an itinerary that's bespoke, that actually appeals to the client, that actually engages them and makes them excited, and not just because it's a thing that you can just tick off your list and say, oh, look, I've got 7 days for you, right? So that feeds into what I'm going to say now, which is, you know, with the snorkeling and stuff, snorkeling and diving in Sri Lanka, you have to be interested in diving to maybe go down that diving path, but and you have to be qualified. But with the snorkeling, like when we go to places like Pigeon Island or Hikkaru, right, people just don't care, right? People will go, they'll walk on the reefs, right? Just because they've got fins on or flippers on, they feel like they're safe. So they don't think about the fact that they're kicking the reefs. They'll take food packets, plastic that'll fly into the water. They'll take disposable plastic water bottles. The boat operators can be very, very careless around those places. So I'm using Pigeon Island as an example. But what we have to remember is, again, step back. When you're selling the package, before a person leaves their country, leaves their home, you should be saying, look, you're going on a trip that is about making sure we're protecting these resources in the long term. So in order to do that, every little step counts. One of the simple steps is carry your own resources, water bottles, etc., right? Be mindful. Don't and if they're going diving and stuff, don't touch things. It's about taking, you don't leave anything behind. You can take memories, we can take photographs in these spaces, but you don't have to take a piece of coral, you don't have to take the shells, you don't have to like destroy the habitat that you go to visit, right? And so it's really, and I am 100%, I've said this for years, the people who really have control over the situation, exactly like Sumit says, is the tour operators, right? Because it's an income generation method. The minute you start to clamp down, the minute you start to take pride in what we have and making sure it's there in the long term, we can make a difference. And I appeal to all of you right now, actually, to consider that. Whatever environment you're sending people to. And again, remember, the oceans, there's very few eyes on the water. So we have to be the eyes. We have to make sure that we're encouraging only those tourists who really care to go out there, who we know will be responsible and want to be there, and not just because they want to like lie on a coral reef or hold onto a coral reef and take a photograph, right? So I would say with everything we do, it's that consciousness that you build from the start, the standard you provide before people have even left their home, that will resonate through the whole trip. And we can't stop them when they get here, but if you've already inculcated that you are a tour operator, you're an agent that believes strongly in long-term sustainability, then that messaging will make sure that their whole trip has minimal damage on the environment.
Thank you, Dr. DeVos. I think there's a lot that we need to consider as tour operators and also as visitors to curate that experience so that we're not overcrowding these resources and also not misusing the resources as well. And as you mentioned, taking things like plastics and disposable items to sensitive ecosystems. And as the saying goes, take nothing but pictures and memories if you must, and leave nothing but footprints, and make sure that the environment is as pristine as possible when you leave it as well. Again, thank you, Dr. DeVos, for taking that question. Ms. Watson, I would like to direct my next question to you. Many times travelers visit national parks hoping to get a glimpse of a leopard and may return without luck. You talked a little bit about this in your presentation as well. Can you share a little bit more about the behavior of leopards and how that can help us perhaps spot leopards better or maybe enjoy the experience even if you don't spot a leopard? And also, what kind of bad behaviors of people have impacts on the behavior of leopards? We get a couple of questions from the audience that I think I will combine with this question as well. For example, one person has asked, can two male leopards share the same territory? Another person has asked, how many black leopards are there? So what can you tell us or what can you share with us about the behaviors of leopards that can perhaps empower us to plan our visits better?
I'll use two questions actually to answer this and then also build on that. Firstly, two male leopards don't usually share their territory because leopards are territorial animals. They maintain their own home ranges. However, you can have areas where they do overlap. So where you have common areas for both animals. And often it is these areas that young leopards, young male leopards will come into and try to see if they can take it over. And in some cases, they're successful because the other resident leopard gives it up in a way because he's got a lot of other space that he needs to, keep under his monitoring. Now, keeping that in mind, and I'm saying Yala again here because that is where a lot of people go to see leopards. And that is also where we have done a lot of work and have discovered that there is this overlap between males. Keeping that in mind, we have to realize that the leopard does not see the landscape as we do. So we have roads, we have jeep trails and tracks, and tour groups and visitors and jeep drivers all ply those roads in a certain way. Often they're, going up and down, looking for leopards. Leopards don't use the landscape in the same way. They see it very differently. They move often across the landscape as opposed to how we go. So often you may well be coming across a leopard who is patrolling his territory. And for him, this is major business. He needs to do this. He needs to do this to ensure that some other young guy is going to come out and kick him. Especially the older they get, they have to patrol more. So if you're going to have, 25, 50 jeeps, and you have to remember that we don't have savannah open systems, like in the Serengeti, where when you have 25 jeeps, it's not that much because it's a big open system. We have much smaller forestscapes. So you are taking up a lot of space here. And we could very easily be disrupting this animal from doing his regular business. So that's an important thing to keep in mind. The other question was about black leopards. I'll just very quickly say, we don't really know, and it's not something you can say for sure there are so many black leopards, because the black leopard is a leopard. It's just, a mother may have a cub that happens to be black. So it's not really something that you can easily censor in that sense, all right? Going back to, I'm going to turn the first question on its head and talk about the fact that I think perhaps we have marketed the leopard too much, in a sense, right? Where it's a matter of just seeing the animal. We don't need to do that. There is so much known about the animal, the fact that it lives in all of our habitat types. That is an experience in itself, telling the story of the animal. Where they are, what they could be doing, looking at their tracks, talking about the landscape, the fact that there could be kills, they're coming to water, what they do. All of this can really build into an experience. But unfortunately, many people, and again, I think this goes back to marketing to people who aren't really interested but just want to come and tick off saw a leopard, about this running around looking for a leopard. Instead, we need to look at the landscape itself and build that wonderful story around that wonderful habitat that we are all. Other things about the behavior that we must keep in mind is, of course, these animals are solitary for the most part, and that they are highly nocturnal, so they move around much more at night than in the daytime, and thankfully in the night, these areas are theirs, so that's a good thing. But even during the crepuscular hours, that's dawn and dusk, when they are moving, and if you are out there and you're lucky to come across a leopard, it's important to realize that they have a lot of business to do. They're going around doing their thing. You may be interfering in them going to their kill or to go to water. And understanding how they're using the landscape would enrich that experience so much more than just running around to look for the leopard. Again, like I said, the leopard uses the landscape very differently to us. So sitting at a water body, for example, waiting for a while, you may be luckier by having a leopard just coming across and drinking, rather than running around, driving around like mad up and down roads to try to find this animal. I think the same goes for the vast ocean. Asha was talking about these boats chasing, instead of just sitting and waiting there, being lucky enough to then come across the species. Again, I think it's important for tour operators, people who are taking everybody in, to understand that we are lucky enough to see the animal, as it were. So why don't we look at the larger scale, the story around it? I think that would really bring a lot more to real wildlife tourism than just running around to see that species. Does that answer the questions that you have?
Yes, it indeed does, Ms. Watson. I'm now taking questions from the audience, and I think since you spoke on this, I would like to extend a little bit on the questions that we have been getting on the leopards. So there are questions protecting leopards from snares that we recently experienced in the Central Highlands. There was a question from one Anthony Shantikumar Perumal, who had sent us that question. There was also another question on leopards being killed outside parks. And the question was whether ecosystems are changing within national parks, and if that is the reason why leopards are wandering out of the national parks. Ms. Watson, would you be able to share a little bit of light on that?
Yes, of course. First, I want to take that comment right there about leopards wandering outside national parks. I think it's very important that we all need to educate ourselves that a national park boundary is human. An animal doesn't know anything about it. In their opinion, it's just another space. Yes, it has become a safer space for it, and perhaps in certain areas, much richer habitat and more prey base and water for it. But they are not just going to stay in there. A lot of our leopards, actually our work is showing that we have a high percentage of our population, as are the elephants, they're outside our national parks. Our national parks used to be hunting reserves and then declared as national parks. So they are all man-made things. So the habitat outside of national parks, since that's why the question was there, are buffers. Yes, they are being cut up. There is no doubt about that. But it's not a case of animals just wandering out because of that. It's a case more of, I think, that we are coming into contact with this elusive creature more because we have changed our behavior. We are more nocturnal, for example. We are out and about during the time that they are. Earlier, for example, in the hill country landscape, there were never humans on the landscape at night, but there are now. So actually, we are changing it and therefore coming into contact more with animals, which is why I think these questions come up, because people feel that they're wandering out, when actually they're not really wandering out, they're just happening to see them more. Could you just remind me on the other question that they asked? Oh yes, about snares. Okay, now this is also interesting, and because we have an international audience here, and because we have all gone through COVID-19 and our lockdowns, this is how human and climate scenarios can impact our wildlife populations as well as us, right? There is a very close interface here, and unfortunately, I think that interface is getting much less. It's blending a lot more. COVID-19 itself has come across from the wildlife side of things. It's because of consumption of wild meat. Many of the other viruses recently, SARS, so on, have all been because of this wildlife-human interaction. So that is something from a One Health perspective that really needs to be considered. But also is the fact that what it has done is it has made people become much more subsistence-oriented, much more reliant, like our ancestors were, on the land. So we have lots of people who had, had to deal with their own food, all of us included. How are we going to get our food in during curfew and lockdown? So people went out there and started planting for themselves, unfortunately hunting for themselves or putting snares down. And that is why we have this spike in leopards being caught in these mixed landscapes where when they moved around, they were encountering these snares that had been laid on the land. So I think it's a really good question. Made us all think a little bit more about this interface of human wildlife and where is that going to take us forward.
Thank you. Yes, indeed. Thank you so much. I think I would like to direct my next question to Dr. Pilipitiya. We have a general question from the audience about how can we sustain tourism post-COVID? And there is also, I'm combining that with a question from Erang, who is asking, does endangered status actually help conservation? Because he feels that when giving the endangered status to an animal, that we are giving a message that other animals are not, that can result in exploitation of other animals. Dr. Pilipitiya, what are your thoughts on this?
See, there are conservationists have different viewpoints on tourism. Some feel that there should be no tourism, while others feel tourism is all right. We must first realize why national parks have been declared. National parks and protected areas have been declared for protection of wildlife so that they can roam freely. So tourism is a privilege, not a right. We must realize that. If it is a privilege, we have to be well behaved. We have to make sure that we are not abusing that privilege by harassing wildlife. Unfortunately, in countries like Sri Lanka, if protected areas are not earning a revenue for the government, there is a great probability that a protected area will be opened up for some other development activity, which would be much more detrimental to wildlife than tourism. So I see tourism as the lesser of two evils. So tourism is something that needs to happen in our protected areas to ensure government, when our government earns revenue, it is not going to use that land for some other form of development. However, we should do it in a way that we do not infringe upon the freedom of wildlife. And the way Anjali was mentioning and Asha was mentioning how we should be observing wildlife is the way we should be doing wildlife tourism, right? So I believe that we should have tourism. In the post-COVID era, we have an opportunity of resetting the system. Because of the COVID regulations, we can start controlling numbers of tourists into protected areas. However, now the Wildlife Department made an announcement that Yala National Park will, the maximum of 150 vehicles will be permitted only. I'm very sorry to say that Saturday the 20th, I believe, the Saturday before that, when it was exceeding and the Wildlife Department stopped exceeding vehicles coming in, as usual, they got orders from upstairs that all the vehicles should be sent in. So if you start doing things like that, you are not going to have resetting wildlife tourism. We are going to have the same old wildlife tourism that we had pre-COVID. So the government of Sri Lanka has to be very serious whether they want to do this and do this right. If they want to do it right, they should then let the professionals do it without interfering. That's number one. The second issue on endangered status. A species is classified as endangered when the population drops to a certain level that we are concerned that the long-term future of this population will be under threat. So that is why species are classified as endangered. However, it doesn't stop there. Unfortunately, in most countries, it stops there by you classifying a species as endangered and nothing else happens. What really should happen is, once you classify a species as endangered, you have to come up with an endangered species recovery plan on how to recover the population back out of endangered status and actually work at it and trying to get these species out of endangered status. Unfortunately, very few countries, and in developing or in Asian countries, we hardly do that. The only success story I can think of has been India and its tigers, where tiger numbers were doubled in about a 20-year period. But that was because there was serious commitment on the part of the government. In fact, although recent politicians take the credit for it, the credit for the tiger recovery in India should go to Prime Minister Indira Gandhi, who started Project Tiger with an objective of trying to recover the species from endangered status. It's still endangered, but at least population numbers have increased by the interventions made by the government. So once we classify a species as endangered, we have to have a recovery plan and actually implement that plan. So if we do that, then it is good. If we don't do that, we are just keeping on classifying species after species as endangered and we do nothing about it. That shouldn't happen. So by classifying a species as endangered, it doesn't mean the others are not important. Others are also important, but the populations in other species haven't declined to a point that their long-term future is a threat.
Thank you, Dr. Pilapitiya. I think very valuable points that you shared as well. We have a question for Dr. DeVos. When we talk about wildlife conservation, by default, we think about wildlife on land. Can you elaborate on what inspired you to get into marine life conservation?
Yeah, so I was just saying, you're absolutely right. Whoever asked that question, you know, we live in this beautiful tropical island in the heart of the Northern Indian Ocean. It's tropical, it's idyllic, it's all those things that people imagine when they think about beautiful tropical beaches and islands. But I will tell you, when I was 18, I said, I'm going to go off and study marine biology. Everybody, all the Sri Lankans I met would be like, but what are you going to do with that degree? Right. So it just goes to show that for us, the ocean is an alien space. And let me explain. So my love for the ocean, or my love, when I was a kid, I wanted to be an adventurous scientist. I was inspired by National Geographic magazines. I wanted to go where no one else would go, see what no one else would see, right? So that was kind of my trajectory. And I had parents who were very enabling. So that was my lucky thing, because everybody else obviously didn't think it was something necessary or possible. And so I sort of fell in love with water. I was brought up to be curious. I didn't go on beach holidays. But I could see the ocean. I saw the ocean every day on the way to school. And I would imagine like that there was so much more out there, you know, that not just this bleak blue tank of water, but what happened if you lifted the lid? And that's sort of where my heart sort of started to beat. And so at 18, I was pretty resolute. I knew that's what I wanted to study. I had to leave Sri Lanka to do it because you can't study to be a marine biologist in this country still. And we're trying to change that through my organization. So watch this space. But so, you know, for me, it was a series of events, but also just the possibility that my family allowed me to believe existed. And I think that was it. And the fact that there were no restrictions, and the fact that I was allowed to dream and be exposed to people who had, I mean, Sir Arthur C. Clarke used to come to my swimming club. He's the famed science fiction writer, and he moved to Sri Lanka to dive. And he used to tell me stories about these creatures of the deep that he would see on a dive, and he would always leave me hanging. And for me, those kinds of tales were what kind of like excited me. But, you know, as a result, I've had to basically carve my path from the very bottom. There weren't sort of existing programs or internships or projects that existed. And for me, it was very much, if I wanted to do it, I had to create it. And I have obviously continued to try to do that, and also now try to create space for others, because I think, you know, like I said, we have 8 times more ocean area than land area. It's the ocean is a common resource, unlike land, which is broken up into parts that belong or are looked after by different entities. The ocean really is vastly just one big free for all. And so we need an army to protect it. And if 70% of our oceans are our planet is ocean, then why is there such a disproportionate number of people who care for it? Which is why I appeal to everyone. Don't think you have to be a marine conservationist. Don't think you have to be, you know, in the field to care for it. What you have to be is a conscious, caring citizen of the world with a desire to leave the world a better place than you found it. And that's what I want. That's why I'm coming to you as in your capacity to consider what steps you take when you're marketing destinations, when you're putting destinations on the map, when you're asking people to go visit, when you're trying to encourage people to travel across the world or whatever, or internally. Your responsibility is gigantic, and the responsibility shouldn't fall on the shoulders of a few people who call themselves conservationists. It should fall on the shoulders of every single person on this planet who wants to live in a healthier planet and who wants to make sure that, you know, in a generation's time, our children aren't turning brown and being like, why didn't you do anything when you had a chance, right? And so for me, my love for the ocean just continued to grow as I learned more about it. Just the mysteries, just the inaccessibility, the fact that nobody really knew. I mean, most people in Sri Lanka didn't know we had whales in our waters. But that's changed now, right? And that to me is a huge victory, because the more we know, the more we can care. And to me, I want people to care. So a lot of the work that we do is not just about the whales, but it's really bringing the marine environment inland to people who would never consider this space or want to indulge in learning about this space, and getting people really excited through various programs and projects and opportunities. So I hope that sort of kind of gives you a bit of a sense of where it comes from. It's a real inner feeling. I don't even know. It's hard to really explain. It's a complete love for a space that I think is truly magical. And we have this amazing opportunity to live on a planet where this exists and encounter these animals. And I want to just highlight everything that everyone said with this one thing I want you all to remember when we market these species, when we market these destinations. I want you all to think about it this way. Imagine you're having Sunday lunch, right, with your family, and you're having ice cream because, you know, ice cream's fun, and you're having a chat with your family and eating. And suddenly a stranger comes crashing through your front door, playing really loud music, like basically throwing garbage everywhere, trying to touch you, trying to grab your food. Right? That is a really stressful, really frightening experience for us. Like, I even when I think about it, I feel like that's really stressful. But remember, that is exactly what we do when we go into these spaces. The ocean is the home of these animals. The forests and the jungles and all these spaces are the homes of all these amazing creatures. And we are visitors, and we all have to remember that. And if we want to be respected in our homes, we have to make sure we respect these animals in theirs.
Thank you, Dr. Diwas. And I think that's an interesting analogy that you picked to kind of help out ourselves in the, well, hooves of wild animals, so to speak, to imagine it would be like for them if they were to come and disrupt our livelihoods. And I hope that helps our visitors understand their responsibility. Dr. DeVos, the next question is also to you. I'm actually combining two questions, one from Hill and the other from Tanya, the dugongs and the killer whales, which are major attractions in other countries, and how can we conserve these species? And Tanya speaks about the coral reefs and especially the ecosystems in the Hikkaduwa waters. So what kind of efforts can we see in terms of conserving these wildlife in our waters?
But I want to say, yes, we have dugongs in our waters. Most people won't know that. It's incredibly rare to see one alive because they're always caught in nets and they're taken illegally for meat. So that's the unfortunate case of the dugong in this country. We have killer whales, but they're pretty elusive, so there's no real guarantee of seeing them. So again, what I want to remind people is it's really about that ocean experience and remembering that we have to conserve all the components. For sure, we have to focus our attention on protecting all of them. But from the side of promotion, we are not a country that can promote dugongs or killer whales as individual species to come see. We need to be sort of encouraging people to come and see the whole package, the ocean as a whole, everything from the tiniest things or the flying fish all the way to the large animals on our in our oceans. So that whole the ocean experience is what I want you to think about, not just a species related experience that you sell. And the other question was in terms of the Hikkaduwa coral reef and stuff. I don't know exactly what the question is, but certainly, you know, like Hikkaduwa is a national park. It is the highest status of protection. We talk about Yala being a mess. Too many cars, too many visitors. If you go to Hikkaduwa, Hikkaduwa is literally the easiest to kind of govern national park because it's just basically off the beach. But somehow it is an absolute mess. You know, tourists will come, local and foreign. I'm not, you know, everybody, and just walk on the reefs. There's a lot of feeding of the turtles that goes on. People will chase the black tip reef sharks. Sometimes I'm really impressed that those animals have been able to habituate in that those conditions and sort of remain. But yes, there's a lot of deterioration of our spaces. We don't have a lot of coral reefs in Sri Lanka because by nature our habitats are a bit different. They're more rocky reefs. We have some and they're not in good shape in general. And so yes, really being more conscious about those spaces as we go into them is incredibly important. And I'll go back to sort of what I said earlier is like when you go into a reef, like, you know, just because you got fins on and because you're safe, because your feet aren't going to get cut if you stand on the coral, doesn't mean you shouldn't be conscious of the coral, because that coral, it takes hundreds of years for some of those corals to grow a few inches. So that goes down to also knowledge, right? Like expose yourself to this knowledge, learn more, because when you talk to your clients, if you want to convincingly tell them not to behave badly, you need to have you have to be convincing in your case. And to be convincing in your case, you have to know the science, you have to know the information. So make that effort to learn more about what's going on and be brutally honest that there are these resources, they're not doing very well. And as a tour operating company, as an agent, as someone who wants people to see the world, you also want them to be mindful of the world that they're interacting with and make sure that they have all the information so they're also making the best decisions.
Thank you, Dr. DeVos. Now I would like to direct a general question to all local tour guides or tour operators might have in terms of planning the safety, in terms of planning excursions, and also the depth of knowledge that they may have. I would like to combine that with a question from Helen Howard from Petites Travel, who also talks about or who asks about the guarantee that a tour operator can provide when they're giving that experience to a traveler from another part of the world. Just to kind of give you a background about Aitkenspence Travels and Aitkenspence Hotels, between these two companies, we have about 40 different management systems that are certified, for example. And so Wells has also developed an internal mechanism called Travel Kindly, where a lot of education is planned for the stakeholders who work with us. And we have more than 100 individuals who are trained within the company to continue that education through our supply chain. So my question to our panelists is, what kind of certification or what kind of accreditation should let's say a traveler or a tour guide look for when coming to Sri Lanka, and what kind of checks or balances, so to speak, should they look for when picking a tour operator to have that wildlife experience? Dr. Pilipitiya, if I can have your thoughts first.
Well, I heard bits and pieces of your question, so I hope I'm answering what you want. Well, first of all, when it comes to wildlife tourism, the experience of your guest still rely on two things. One, how good is your safari jeep driver, and how good is your nature interpreter or the naturalist, right? If the two of them are good, your safari experience will be good. If the two of them are bad, your safari experience is not going to be a very good experience. So now, since most of the, there is no, other than having a driver's license, there is no other requirement for a person to become a safari jeep driver. So that's where the Wildlife Department and the Sri Lanka Tourism Development Authority jointly started last year, in fact, in 2018, started a program of trying to train safari jeep drivers on driving etiquette inside national parks, as well as giving them some knowledge on nature interpretation. So this was started off in Minneria and Kaudulla, and about 70% of Vilpattu drivers also have been trained. So altogether, about 1,200 safari jeep drivers have been trained, and they are issued a certificate at the end of the training program. And that's where the Wildlife Department has decided only certified, trained, certified jeep drivers will be permitted. The department also has a plan. Now, they plan on expanding this to all the other national parks. Now, this is a very basic, like a foundation training course. Then they are going to have an optional training course in the future for safari jeep drivers and guides who want to specialize in birds or leopards or whales or elephants, more species specific training. So if those training and certification is given, when the tour operator is selecting a driver or a guide, you should look for such certifications. If your guest is interested in birds, don't send him with an elephant certified guide. The guest is not going to be happy, right? So whereas if your guest is interested in birds, identifying a driver and a guide who is certified in interpretation of bird behavior would be somebody that you should send. So if you start selecting like that, I think you can ensure a better experience for your guests. And I know right now these training programs are in its infancy, but it is happening, because already 1,200 have been trained, and Sri Lanka Tourism and Wildlife wants to start it in Yala next. So we are going to go from national park to national park doing this training. So you need to look for people like that. That is the safari experience training, is that. Okay, I hope I answered your question, because you were not very clear. You were breaking up in at several points.
Sorry, Dr. Pilipitiya, about that. But yes, you did answer the question. Can I quickly move on to Ms. Watson to give your insights about the same question about what kind of credibility should we look for the tour operators that we work with?
Sumit has already mentioned the side of, you know, the logistics of the driver and the guide and so on. I'm going to play devil's advocate here and toss that question actually back at the tour agents and so on, and ask what it is that they would like to see, and should or could they ask and demand for a higher end product. Now, many people come, visit, say they had a horrible experience and go, right? I've been told this by many people. I think many tour operators may have got this feedback. Not all, obviously, that's not, you know, across the board. But there are particular scenarios where they talk about overcrowded, you know, when it comes to leopard sighting, that kind of thing. But very few people actually speak up. So if on the supply side, there is no total awareness of this fact, and nobody's speaking up on the demand side of it and demanding a better quality product, then, you know, it's going to be a bit of a disjunct here. Yes, of course, as Sumit mentioned, on one side, on the supply side, there has to be a much better overall, experience being put forward. But I also think there needs to be much more discerning as a traveler to be able to demand something a little more. So doing your homework, again, as Asha mentioned, finding out who is actually going to do the right thing, looking at the packages. I mean, many times, although everyone says curated packages, special this, that, it's the same thing, really. Everybody's going to Yala, everybody's going to Sigiriya, everybody's going to Horton Plains, you know, it's the same thing. So looking a little bit more at what is also being requested for and tailoring that to try to balance both sides here.
Absolutely. Dr. DeVos, can I direct the same question as to you as well? What are your thoughts on the point of credibility to the tour operators?
Yeah, absolutely. So I think I touched on kind of all the points that have been put out, which is tour operators have a responsibility. So don't be complacent and just expect an amazing to send your people on a tour and, you know, expect them to have an amazing time. Do your homework. I would say always get feedback from your clients, because if you can get feedback, but act on that feedback, right? Like if you have a, once you sell the package, that's really shouldn't be the end. You should, and maybe you guys do this, but anyway, just to reiterate, you know, ask questions. Like when you went on the whale watching trip, was there an educational component to it? Did you feel like you learned something? Were they considerate about the environment? Were they considerate about the animals? Did they have the safety equipment? Did you feel safe? It's not just because there's lots of boats out there. They all have life jackets, but that doesn't mean you're going to be safe. And I can guarantee that, right? You can ask them, you know, what was it like before the trip? Did they give you a brief? So there are lots of questions. And I mean, you know, I'm happy to, if there are any specific tour operators who are interested in specific questions, we have surveys that we run, actually, and I'd be more than happy to sort of work with some of you tour operators out there to try to get some more of this information, because we are trying to find out that information too. But I can tell you that the biggest complaint with whale watching stuff is people feel like they don't get an educational experience. So go online, do your homework. Places like TripAdvisor, you have to sift through a lot, but there are gems of information there that can help you with aligning yourself with operators on the ground that are actually better. There is information available out there, not just the generic good trip, bad trip. There are things like, I felt like I was kidnapped because I was on this boat for like 8 hours and the weather was terrible and everyone was vomiting. Now that's not someone you want to align with either, right? So the certification scheme, certainly for what we do, don't really, I would say don't really say much, because once people leave the port, no one's watching, so we can't really monitor it. So I wouldn't say go for like a generic certification scheme. Use your intuition in searching for the information that can help you to find those better operators. So education is always a big complaint. So I would say, you know, talk to your clients and say, if you went on a trip with so-and-so, like, did you have an education experience? Very few of them will do a talk before to prepare people for the trip, and then there's very little talking on the boat in many situations. And what people are going to enhance, they should be going to enhance their overall experience and also knowledge, right? So it's not just about pointing at a whale and saying blue whale. And that's where I get a lot of complaints. Like people will be like, it's cool, I saw a blue whale, but like, whatever, right? And I'm like, what? It's a blue whale. But the point is that they have no information beyond this animal that just keeps coming up and diving, keeps coming up and diving, right? So you can't expect them to appreciate too. And you can transform people that maybe are complacent about the environment to people who appreciate the environment by giving them these added nuggets, right? So I would say definitely. And also don't partner with the cheapest operators because they're not the best. And, you know, that's a fact. Okay, they are basically trying to just get people out on the water, quickly show them something and rush back. So there is a value for money system for sure, I can say, on the whale watching operators. The more expensive operators have more things in place and provide much more of an experience. And there is a reason why they charge more, and they have a lot more clients as well. So despite their price point. So I would say key things are look at the educational aspects, look at reviews, look at really making the effort to find the people who are actually going to provide your clients with a better experience, and take them through the whole journey from the time they leave to the time they come back, and mine that information so that you can ensure that your next batch of tourists have a much better experience.
Thank you, Dr. DeVos. And actually, after that last question, I have a lot of newfound respect for my colleagues at Aitken Spence Travels, who have taken a lot of time to not only educate tour guides and all the stakeholders who work with us on the ground, but I have personally been with them when they actually got into the vehicles, rode along with them, just to share their insights about what should or shouldn't be done, and to also kind of understand the point of view of the Jeep drivers and the chauffeur guides and so on, to kind of meet them halfway, to educate them about what needs to happen moving forward as well. So it's not only about schooling the stakeholders, it's also about empowering them with the right knowledge so that they become protectors for our valuable ecosystems. Interesting conversation that we have going, but unfortunately, that's all the time that we have for this discussion today. So I'm keeping all fingers crossed that Aitken Spence Travels and Aitken Spence Hotels will host another event like this so that we can have even more participants joining. Today we had 100 guests joining on Facebook Live and 450 participants on Teams as well. So I'm sure with a, let's say, an add-on session, we will have even more participation because the discussion is definitely so valuable. And I hope everyone who participated listened in and absorbed all of that as well. So between the rolling hills and the blue oceans, there is another world that is still waiting to be explored, clearly. Indeed, the pearl of the Indian Ocean has many more gems to offer if we are willing to look for them. After that session, I would like to repeat again, I realize what a lot I don't know about Sri Lanka, and I've lived pretty much my whole life in this country. So thank you so much for spending your time with us. On behalf of Aitken Spence Travels, I would like to extend our gratitude to all three of our panelists, Dr. Pillapitiya, Dr. Asha DeVos, and Ms. Watson, for taking the time to be with us, working with us as we kind of smoothed out a few kinks even before the session started. So thank you so much for taking the time to be with us and also sharing your valuable insights. A big thank you to Aitken Spence Hotels for partnering with us to host this event as well. And also 100 participants on FB and 450 participants on Microsoft Teams. Thank you so much for joining in from across the world, especially all our key stakeholders. We hope we have provided a better insight or better information to plan your tours to Sri Lanka. Let's hope the wildlife wonder of Asia will get her due. And let's also hope we work together as equal stakeholders in this matter to protect the amazing gift that nature has given to us in abundance. Thanks again to everyone involved. And thank you especially to our panelists and all those who participated, and enjoy the rest of your evening. Thank you very much.